Before we actually get into the word that the Lord's given me tonight, I want to share with you something. Most of you know that on Wednesday nights we have corporate prayer in here where we come together and we put on some music and we turn off all the lights. And some nights we come together and we have prayer targets where we actually pray over. But most of the time when the lights go out, everybody just kind of finds them in altar somewhere. Some folks walk around and pray. Some people lay on the floor and pray. And so we always just have a powerful time of prayer on Wednesday night. And this past week, I really felt like the Lord gave me a word that he wanted me to share with the body tonight, and that is this. I felt like the Lord was saying that we are about to enter into a season where he's going to start waking his people up in the middle of the night. He's going to call them out of the bed and into the secret place. And what's going to happen is he's going to start revealing truths to you in the middle of the night. Some of you are going to find yourself where you're not going to be able to fall asleep. And you might think it was the chili that you ate. But really, God is saying, no, you're not asleep yet because I want you to get out of your bed and I want you to go into the secret place because I want to reveal some truth to you. So I want to encourage you tonight. If you wake up in the middle of the night and that's just not normal for you, I want to encourage you to get out of your bed. Find a place alone in the house and just begin to seek the face of God. If you have a problem falling asleep, get out of your bed and go seek the face of God. You know what the Lord put on my heart this week as he was speaking this to me? I was praying right over here. He reminded me of the book of Esther in the 6th chapter. Do you guys remember that story? It says that the king could not fall asleep. Do you remember that? And he called for the chronicles to be brought to him and read to him, hoping that that would help him fall asleep, right? But what happened while those chronicles were being read? Truth was revealed. Because earlier in the book of Esther, there was a plot by some men to take out the king. And Mordecai is the one who told Esther about this plot, but it was the brown noser Haman that took credit for it. Right? But as the chronicles were being read, the king finds out the truth. Whoa. Can you back up? Did you say that was Mordecai? What's been done for Mordecai? I didn't know that he's the one responsible for saving my life. Truth was revealed while the king could not sleep. So I want to encourage you, this has nothing to do with what I'm preaching about tonight. This is just a free nugget, okay? I want to encourage you, if you find yourself not being able to sleep, it's because God is calling you out of the sack and into the secret place where he will begin to speak to you through prayer and getting into his word, amen? So I want to encourage you with that tonight. So I want to pray again before we open up the word tonight and we get into it. So if you bow with me. Father, we thank you again for the opportunity to be into your house tonight. We thank you for the opportunity to come together as a body of believers and to worship you in spirit and in truth. God, I'm asking tonight that you would just give me an instructed tongue, that every word that comes out of my mouth tonight would be guided by your Holy Spirit and not by me. I'm asking, Lord, that you would make our minds awake tonight, that our hearts would be a place for this seed, this word, that it would be good soil. Our hearts would be good soil that the seed falls on tonight, that it would produce fruit for the kingdom of God. Lord, I'm praying that this word would not be confusing, but it would be crystal clear to us tonight, and it would challenge us to be more like you. God, work in our lives tonight as we surrender ourselves to you, and we ask it in the mighty name of Jesus, and everyone says amen. All right, so I'm going to put this title up on the screen for you tonight, and then hopefully try to explain this. So the title of the message tonight is Misdemeanor versus Felony. Misdemeanor versus Felony. I want to read you the definition of this word misdemeanor. If you look this word up, of course, or this is what I found when I looked it up. It says a minor wrongdoing. A minor wrongdoing. And then I looked up the word felony that says a crime regarded as more serious than a misdemeanor. A crime regarded as more serious than a misdemeanor. So here we are, misdemeanor versus felony. I actually brought with me tonight a Florida State statute book. You see this thing? This thing is thick, all right? And in 12 years of or so of law enforcement, I've had to break this book open on many occasions. Now, sometimes you have common arrest that you make over and over and over again, and you just remember that statute. Like, for instance, driving on a suspended driver's license. None of y'all have ever done that, I know, but that statute is 322.34, and depending on how many offenses it's been depends on the subsection of that statute. But I want to talk to you for a few minutes about this statute book tonight, because in this very thick book here is information. It is a guide. It's a man-made guide that tells us about every crime committed in the state of Florida, whether it is a misdemeanor or a felony, okay? And in this book, here are some important things that I'm going to teach you about this book tonight. This book includes a statute number for every crime committed. Every crime that has been defined in the state of Florida is assigned its very own statute number. In fact, when you fill out a probable cause affidavit, when a law enforcement officer fills out a probable cause affidavit, he has to put down the statute number and the charge, the crime that was committed. And if it's wrong, there's going to be some issues with the courthouse. Okay. Secondly, this book, as you read past the statute number, will give you the elements of every crime. It will tell you if this crime is committed, these elements must have happened in order for you to charge them with this crime. You with me? Thirdly, this book will tell you the seriousness of the crime, whether this crime is a misdemeanor in the first, second, or third degree, or a felony in the first, second, third degree. And it will also tell you the punishment for that crime. So it gives you a statute number, it gives you the elements. You can look at these elements and say, okay, if these elements were met, this crime occurred. Now this is the charge. It's a misdemeanor, it's a felony in the first, second, or third degree. Follow with me, please. We're going somewhere with this. And then it will also tell you the exact punishment. What can be done to you because of the crime that you committed? Again, I want to remind you that this is a man-made guide. I'm going to give you an example tonight. This is a lesson you didn't know you were going to get in law enforcement tonight, okay? So I'm just opening this statute book up, and I'm going to the charge of robbery. That statute number starts with 812.13, and this is what it reads. It says, robbery means the taking of money or other property which may be the subject of larceny from the person or custody of another with intent to either permanently or temporarily deprive the person or the owner of that money or the property when in the course of taking this, they use force, violence, or assault or put fear into the victim. That's how you know you have a robbery. You got that? Okay. Then it goes on to tell you, let's say, well, you've got robbery by sudden snatching, robbery by using a firearm, and it breaks it down, and it tells you everything you need to know about all these crimes, how serious they are, the punishment that's coming your way, up to what you can receive according to this punishment. Now, I said all that to say this. If we are not careful in the spirit realm, many times we like to determine in our own minds the seriousness of the sins that we are committing, and we'll say, oh, well, whoa, this is just a misdemeanor right here. This is small potatoes. This is not a big deal. You know what I'm saying? You guys, are you guys with me? Is this going to be a tough night for me tonight? When I was, we determine in our minds the sin that we are committing, whether it's a misdemeanor or a felony, if it's minor or if it's major. Amen. Thank you. When I first got saved, I was 13 years old, and obviously I was very spiritually immature, and I was very biblically ignorant to the Word of God. And I quickly started to categorize my sins. Why y'all looking at me like I'm crazy? Because y'all have all done that at some point in time in your life. You're like, hey, I'm better than her because I know what she's done. I haven't done that, right? Is it really going to be like this tonight? I would say to myself, you know, a lie is just a misdemeanor, okay? It's like, you know, it's not murder. A lie is just something that's small. It's like kind of like the difference between driving on a suspended license and shooting somebody. We compare these, right? Oh, I haven't committed any of the felonies in the Bible. I haven't committed any of the major offenses in the Bible. I've just, you know, every once in a while might not tell the truth. I would say myself, punishment for a lie cannot be the same as punishment for murder. I would say to myself, telling a lie is like stealing a penny versus, you know, murder, which would be like stealing $1 million. Y'all ever done that before? No, not steal $1 million. Have you ever put a category on the offense of your sin?
Yes. Or someone else.
Amen to that. I want to talk to you for a few minutes tonight, and before the main theme of this tonight is talking about the seriousness of telling the truth and not lying. Here's my disclaimer. Nothing happened this week that I'm aware of. Nobody that I know of has told some heinous lie, and I've decided to preach against that person tonight. That's my disclaimer. I've told you guys many, many times before, throughout the week, I pray and I seek the Lord, and I say, Lord, what do you want for us this week? And I say, whatever it is, Lord. I asked the Lord to give it to me by Wednesday because I like to have it written down and studied up by Wednesday and spend a couple days meditating on it. But every once in a while, like this week, it's Friday and I'm still screaming out and begging to God, saying, God, what do you want for us this week? Why are you doing this to me? You know, this is going to sound prideful, and I'm not trying to be prideful, but as long as I've been doing ministry, I can open this Bible and come up with a message. Okay, any of y'all could do that. If you're a teacher, you can open this Bible and come up with a message anytime you want to, and it will be good because it's the Word of God. But I'm not after what I want to try and come with. I'm after for what the Holy Spirit wants for us as people to hear. And so the Lord began dealing with me this week about talking about His people being truth speakers and the seriousness of lying. See, the devil wants to try to diminish the seriousness of a lie. Not just a lie. He wants to try to diminish the seriousness of any sin. But this lie, he'll say to you, look, lying is small potatoes, Dee Dee. You're good. If all you do every once in a while is not tell the truth, you're good. You're not killing anybody. You're not stealing anything. You know, you're not out there committing some heinous crime. You're just telling a lie. You're okay. Isn't that how the devil works? He always tries to diminish and make us think that our sin is not that serious. But we can't go by what the devil says. We got to go by what the Word says, right? Again, let me take you back to how I used to think when I was very ignorant to the Word of God and very spiritually immature. I used to tell myself all the time, well, you know, a lie, that's no big deal. It's not like adultery. It's not like murder or all these any other heinous crimes that you can come up with. It's just a lie. And then one day I open up my Word, and I want to read you this scripture. It's found in 1 Timothy chapter 1, and I want to start at verse 9. It says, we also know that the law is made not for the righteous, but for the lawbreakers and rebels, the ungodly, the sinful, the unholy, the irreligious, for those who kill their fathers and mothers, for murderers, for adulterers, for perverts, for slave traders, and liars, and perjurers. Let me hit the brakes here. Wait a minute, God. Did you just put in the same category someone who kills their father and their mother? You also included a liar with that group. You included a liar in the group of a pervert, an adulterator. What? That right there blew my theory as a young, immature, ignorant to the word of God, blew my theory of a lie is okay. Boy, it's going to be tough sledding in here. Tough sledding in here. Flip over to Revelation chapter 21. I want to read this scripture to you. The unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, or it could just say those who practice witchcraft, the idolaters, and all liars, their place will be in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. Here again, we see God putting a liar in the same category as vile, murderer, someone who practiced witchcraft, an idolater. You know, all of these things, God, you know, telling a lie falls into that same category. God, would you please give me something very uplifting next week to preach to your people? Something cheerful. Chapter 6, yes, 16 through 19. There are six things the Lord hates. Seven that are detestable to him. Look at this, verse 17. Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood. Through 19. There are six things the Lord hates, seven that are detestable to him. Look at this, verse 17. Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked schemes, feet that are quick to rush into evil, a false witness who pours out lies. Did you catch? Six things that the lying tongue and a false witness who pours out lies, and a man who stirs up dissension among brothers. Could that last piece, a man who stirs up dissension among brothers, also be someone who goes around telling falsehoods about others? Right? Now, I want you to understand this, because the scripture does not say there are six things that the Lord hates the person who does this. That's not what it says. It says there are six things that the Lord hates. He doesn't hate the individual. He hates the thing that the individual is doing. Okay? Out of those six that the scripture says that the Lord hates, two give a reference to being someone who tells a lie. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 22 tells us the Lord detests lying lips, but he delights in men who are truthful. This word detest is defined as an intense dislike. The Lord detests lying lips, but yet he delights in men who are truthful. This word delights means to please someone greatly. Men who are truthful, this word delights means to please someone greatly. Why do you think that the Lord detests and hates lying so much? That answer is given to us in Scripture in John chapter 8. Flip over to John chapter 8, going to verse 42. We gotta get this. Starting at verse 42, Jesus is speaking here to the Pharisees, and he says, "If God were your father, you would love me, for I came from God and now am here. I have not come on my own, but he sent me. Why is my language not clear to you? Because you are unable to hear what I say. You belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desire." Now listen to what Jesus says. "He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language." He's fluent in lying. "For he is a liar and the father of lies." Do you know why God detests lying so much? Do you know why God hates lying so much? It's right here in this scripture. It tells us very clearly. Number one, it says that the devil is a murderer, right? He does not hold to the truth. There is no truth in him. And when he speaks lies, which is his native language. Can you understand this? When you let a lie come out of your mouth, you are speaking the devil's language. That is why God detests lying so much, because you are speaking the devil's language. The scripture tells us that Satan is the father of lies. He was the first liar. Lying was birthed from him. The very DNA of a lie comes from Satan. He has fathered every lie that has ever been spoken or will be spoken comes from Satan himself. And when we speak it, it's coming from Satan, and we are speaking Satan's language. Are we catching the seriousness of, listen, lying is not a misdemeanor. It is not small potatoes, not in the eyes of our Heavenly Father. God detests lying lips, but he delights in someone who will speak the truth, even when the truth is not going to benefit you personally. See, that's what it all comes down to. Is what I'm about to say going to benefit me? Or is it going to cause me some harm? We're talking about the truth here, right? A lot of times we only like to speak the truth or be people of our word when it's going to benefit us. I remember when my oldest son, Drake, who is now 20, he was 4 years old. He would sit at the big window in the front of our house while I was out there sweating to death, pushing the grass or cutting the grass. He would do this. Seriously, and he would just watch me, and I'd come in all hot and sweaty, and he'd say, "Daddy, can I please cut the grass?" And I'd say, "Son, you're not old enough to cut the grass right now. That's dangerous. You got, well, you promise me when I get older that I can cut the grass." I said, "Son, I promise you. I promise you when you get older, you're going to cut the grass, and I am a man of my word." See, it's easy to be a man or woman of our word when it benefits us. Amen? Every lie spoken is conceived from the devil, because the scripture says that he is the father of lies. Do you remember the story of Ananias and Sapphira in Acts chapter 5, verse 3? Peter says this. He says, "Ananias, how is it?" This is verse 3 in chapter 5 of Acts. "Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit?" Do you see the tying in of this? The lie came from Satan. Conceived from Satan. He allowed Satan into his heart. The DNA of that lie was birthed into him, Ananias, and his wife from Satan himself, because he is the father of lies. It's no wonder the scripture tells us that our Father in heaven detests lies, that he hates lies, because when someone lies, they are speaking the devil's language. They are speaking something that was conceived from the devil himself. You know, I looked up this week, top reasons why people lie. Seriously, I did that. Top reasons why people lie. Number one, to avoid consequence. Son, did you take that cookie? Crumbs all over their face, chocolate all over. No. I didn't do that. We've all been in a situation where we were put on the spot when someone asked us a question and we knew if we answered it truthfully, there was going to be some serious consequence to it. And it's like, and the devil is saying, just lie. Let me cover this for you. Let me conceive a lie for you, because God does not put the thought of a lie in your mind. That comes from the devil. He's the father of lies. The DNA of a lie comes from the devil, not from God. To avoid consequence, can I tell you tonight, if I had a dollar, every time someone looked me in the eyes and told me, I did not do that, I could retire right now and live comfortable. I was investigating a case one time. We had a guy crystal clear on camera, crystal clear, committing a crime. Pulled him into the interview room. Asked him a bunch of questions. Nope, wasn't me, wasn't there, never. I was out of town, you know, this, that, and other thing. I said, okay, well, let me just show you this video right here. And I mean, this was 1080p. I'm talking, this was crystal clear. He watches this video. His whole demeanor changes. And this is what he says after watching the video. He says, that wasn't me. He says, I know why you would think it was me, because it looks just like me, but that wasn't me. The top reason why people lie is to avoid the consequence. But let's get this clear tonight. Do you want to avoid man's consequences or God's consequence? Revelation chapter 22, I want to read another scripture. Starting at verse 12, Jesus is speaking, behold, I am coming soon. My reward is with me, and I will give it to everyone according to what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may go out the gates into the city. What city is he talking about? The New Jerusalem. He's talking about heaven. Outside are the dogs, those who practice witchcraft, the sexually immoral, the murderers, the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood or lies. Jesus just gave, right here in the book of Revelation, the consequence of being a liar. He says to you and I, we will not inherit the kingdom of God if we are a liar. Which consequence would you rather have to deal with? Your wife getting mad at you? Some of you are like, oh, brother, I don't want to have to deal with that at all. Being put on restriction? Can you weigh this out? Restriction versus missing out on heaven. I think I'll take the restriction. Avoid consequence. Number two, to impress people. You ever been around somebody that just spewed lies out of their mouth just to try to impress you? And it's like, man, like someone has to be really very ignorant to believe everything that you're saying. Like, you know, if everything that you're saying is true, you are the greatest person that God ever created. But people lie to try to gain acceptance and to impress people with things that they have never even done to make themselves look good. I don't know about you guys, but I'm more interested in impressing my Father in heaven, for I don't care what y'all think about me. I really don't. I'll go home and I'll still sleep good unless the Lord wakes me up to pray. But I want to impress him. I already know I don't have the goods to impress any of y'all anyway. I don't care. But trying to, lying just to impress other people, that's your reward. Oh, so-and-so thinks you're great. What's that going to get you? Not much. Think about it just for a second. How many of you, let's take yourself back when you're younger, and you're just getting to know somebody, and boy, they just told you, they smoothed you up, they convinced you they were the best thing since peanut butter and jelly with everything that they told you. Sold you a bill of goods. Number three, to obtain the reward not otherwise obtainable. Can you gather that? Telling a lie just so you can get something in return that you wouldn't have been able to get if you hadn't told that lie. Wow. Think of the reward that you're trading. Nothing on this earth is more valuable than to make it to heaven and look our Father in the face and hear those words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Number four, to avoid conflict. Y'all know you've all done it. Somebody asks you a question, it's like, oh man, if I tell the truth, there's gonna be some serious problems here. Right? So you're just like, oh, it's just a misdemeanor. I'll just tell them this and it's all good. No, it's not good. It may be good in the present with that person, but is it good with your Father? I'd rather have conflict with man than conflict with God. Number five, and there's a bunch of them, but I'm going to stop with number five, to protect someone else. You ever done that before? Told a lie just to protect someone else? But you ain't protecting yourself when you tell that lie. God is calling his people to be truth speakers. Truth speakers. Speaking the word. That's our top priority of speaking truth, is the word. Because what? The truth will set you free, right? But also God has called us to be truthful and speak truth in our day-to-day operations, in our day-to-day relationships. He's called us to be truthful in all of those things. You want to come on up and start playing? I'm going to wind this down. The truth sometimes isn't always favorable in the immediate for you in the situation that you're in. But it's always favorable in the eyes of God. My youngest son, Drew, who's sitting in here tonight, as with any kid, all kids at point in time are mischievous in life, right? As with any kid, he's done some things he probably shouldn't have done. All of us have, right? But you know what? One of the things I cherish about him, David, is I'll sit him down and I'll look him right in the eyeballs and I'll say, son, did you do this? And he'll say, yes. Dead serious. There is no, did you do this? I mean, it might be something that's like, there's going to be major consequences. Did you do this? Yes, I did. And he knows what's coming to him. But he speaks the truth. He has decided in his heart that he's going to tell his father the truth, even though it's going to cost him something. You hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
There is never a time that it is okay to tell a lie. Because the scripture tells us that God detests and hates lies. He's called us to be truth speakers. Even when... Honey, does this dress look great on me tonight? You know, there's a few other ones that look a little bit better on you than that. I knew that was going to get you guys. Because the answer is always, I don't care what you're wearing, you look great. But you guys know the point I'm trying to get across. Sometimes you're put in a situation where someone asks you a question and the truth is not going to be received favorably. You hear me? And it's so easy to tell a lie to avoid the conflict of that. But that's not what God has called us to be. I want to challenge you tonight to remember who we are in Christ, and that God's people should never, ever, ever allow be God's people should never, ever, ever speak the language of the devil.
That's right.
Ever. Stand with me, please. Would you guys pray and fast for me this week that God just really gives me a very uplifting, encouraging word for next Saturday night? Here's the challenge as we go out upon our daily business, whatever your business is that we're truth speakers, first and foremost, truth speakers of this word, and then second, we always speak the truth no matter what the situation is, okay? It doesn't matter if it's a business deal, right? Somebody asks you the question and you know that the answer to it may cost you a little bit on that business deal. Can I just say this really quick? It is so easy to find yourself in a situation, especially where you might be tight on money, struggling in a situation, and you need to close that deal, and somebody asks you that question, and you know that maybe if you tell the truth, it might cost you that deal, and your mind immediately starts going towards, I need this money. Remember, even if it's not favorable for you in the flesh, in the spirit, it's always favorable for us when we speak the truth. Again, we find ourselves closing. As I said a few weeks ago, I preached on the spirit of lust, and I knew to make an altar call when you talk about lust, boy. You ain't gonna have a bunch of people running down to that. Same thing when we're talking about lying. Did you know that there are people, and when I say this, some of you you're gonna identify with what I'm saying. There are people who are compulsive liars. Okay? There's a difference between someone who just lies occasionally, even though that's still wrong, but there's a spirit of lying that will attach itself to people where they find themselves compulsively lying on a regular basis, even over the most insignificant things that have no meaning whatsoever. Somebody asks them a question, where did you go to school? And they'll lie about that. That's a spirit that has attached itself to someone when they're compulsively lying all the time. That person needs to be delivered in the name of Jesus from that lying spirit. And you guys know there are a lot of people like that. Every time you're around them, it doesn't matter what you ask them, they're going to lie. They're going to tell a lie. If you know somebody like that, you need to be praying and fasting for that person that God would deliver them from that lying spirit. But as Christ followers, we should always be truth speakers in every situation. Bow with me. Father, we thank you for your word tonight. Father, the word of God is our life manual. It is active, it's alive, it's sharper than a double-edged sword. It speaks to us. And I ask tonight, God, that you would challenge each one of us tonight to be truth speakers in every situation, speaking the truth of the Word of God, speaking the truth when asked a question, speaking the truth in love, telling the truth even when in the flesh the consequence may not be good for us. But Lord, help us to remember that you delight in the one who is truthful, and you detest lying lips. God, I pray that you would wake us up in the middle of the night, in the weeks to come, that we would recognize it, that we would have the discernment in the spirit realm, and that we would get out of our beds with our word, and we would go into the secret place and allow you to begin to speak to us. Reveal truths, reveal the traps that the enemy is trying to lay out in front of us. Give us wisdom and discernment. And use us for your glory and for the glory of the kingdom of God. And we ask it tonight in the mighty name of your Son, Jesus. Amen and amen.